So I've spoken to Silas a lot. So I'm going to start with Daniel. As the kernel, the whole thing started with you, right? So I would love to know, how did you get the idea for the play, first of all?
Yeah, I think there were sort of several different sources of inspiration that kind of converged, as sometimes happens. I think I remember reading one article, this is back in 2011 or 12, actually. And it was about gender nonconforming kids of and sort of the conversation around that issue and the different choices parents were making. And it sort of struck me, you know, initially, I guess, as someone who'd had my own princess dress-up phase when I was sort of, you know, Jake's age, just what a different conversation it was than the one that was happening for my parents. And so I guess that was sort of one curious thing. And I think the other thing that sort of dovetailed with that was my day job since I moved to New York almost 10 years ago, till very recently, actually, was always been tutoring.
Congratulations, by the way.
Thank you very much.
Not having a day job anymore?
It is very...
It's the goal, right?
It is.
SAG people?
It's a new experience.
Yeah.
And that was at the middle school and high school level, sort of all over New York. And, you know, a lot of private school families, also some public, you know, gifted programs, things like that. And I was sort of struck by, you know, a lot of these kids were applying to college, and so it was dealing with the families and the whole, you know, pressure cooker situation. I was sort of over and over struck by how the sort of fundamental separation anxiety about watching kids grow up, well, all that anxiety on the parents' part would often get sort of channeled into anything they thought they could control, like, you know, whether it was grades or testing or you know, or the right school. And, you know, when really what they were most scared of, I think, you know, was just seeing their kids grow up and leave the nest. And obviously I was not tutoring four-year-olds, but I think when I sort of, when these two sources of inspiration kind of converged, in a way it struck me as kind of a similar precipice moment for parents that, you know, at 4 and 5, when kids are about to, you know, sort of leave the sort of Edenic world of, you know, before kindergarten. And then you sort of start thinking about who these people are, and little by little, the idea kind of gets bigger and bigger. But those were the sort of two things I think that were kicking around in my head early on.
Can you talk about the decision to focus on the adults more than the kid? Because that was one of the things I found so refreshing, is that, you know, Leo is a wonderful actor, but it's kind of a surprising that, you know, he's not in the film more, and Silas can speak to this too, but that it really is more about the parents.
Yeah, well, when it was a play, Jake is not in the play, he's not on stage at all, and that's partly for practical considerations. If a four-year-old in a play is a bigger ask than in a movie, it can be, you know, problematic for several reasons. But I think mostly I was, you know, so when I was writing the play, I've always been interested in the way in which children are sort of vehicles for projection and interpretation, you know, that you know, especially that age 4 and 5, when they're kind of starting to be, I mean, that's not true. They're humans long before, but when they're, you know, I read one article that about how, like, around 4 is when kids usually start to keep secrets, when they realize, oh, they can actually keep things from their parents. And, you know, it's a really fascinating time developmentally, because they are starting to separate themselves from their parents in really profound ways. And I don't have kids myself, but, you know, it's always been something that was really fascinating to me. And I think, you know, so when writing the screenplay, you know, I think we knew early on that to have Jake off screen entirely was going to feel contrived and forced in a way it wouldn't in a play. But at the same time, I think, the movie really is more about the adults around Jake, and more about their struggles to protect him and interpret him. And, you know, I think ideally, you know, you want to feel that each adult in the movie is seeing a slightly different Jake, which I think happens with kids, and I think happens, frankly, with, you know, all of our subjective experiences. But I think that was, you know, he's sort of the nexus of the story. But I think I think Silas, you know, would agree that we did really want to look more at everyone around Jake, and that was very much kind of just the conceit, you know, at its core. I don't know if you want to add to that.
And so in your direction, how did you, that's obviously something you guys talked about, but.
Yeah, no, yeah. I think, you know, for me, it was at first counterintuitive as a trans person to not show the gender expansive kid, but given the age and the way that the world, you know, that it became something I absolutely wanted to do, which was to not put the camera on the four-year-old for the audience to decide what is, you know, to start thinking over, you know, and deconstructing the gender or thinking about that, because it just wasn't about that. It was about the ambiguity and about the support at an age where kids have so much expression, and shame can really impact, you know, so early on. I mean, we can remember those moments as kids when we're sort of shut down and, you know, either by parents or society or at school. Anyway, so it felt very important to not focus on the child and to flip the camera to the world around that was making all these decisions. It felt like an actual, like, important decision. But that said, to really feel organic, and it was an interesting exercise in, like, the power of the close-up, because we see Jake a lot, but I felt like people really feel like they don't see Jake till the end, in a sense, you know, because of, you know, the way that the story, we lose Jake as the parents lose Jake, and but in the beginning, we do see Jake's face, and we're not hiding Jake, but then, you know, we definitely are as the parents lose him, and you start to, you hear his voice, or, you know, whatever. So yeah, it was an interesting, you know, it was an interesting exercise in what the power of the close-up and sort of traditional storytelling, visual storytelling, how that plays out when you're denying that, you know, without wanting it, making sure that it doesn't read as dystopian or horror film or like something's wrong with Jake in this way that we really can't look at him. So yeah, it was an interesting journey to find that.
There are a lot of shots of like the side of him in profile or playing, and are there any close-ups of him?
Yeah. Actually, we opened the film on his face.
Right.
Like for a long time, but still people don't remember. I know that's the beginning of the film, but it's interesting how much we actually just spend the whole beginning on Jake's face. But by the end of the film, you feel like you haven't seen him until the end, which is great because it's kind of the journey. I mean, we really don't see him until his parents do.
Daniel, can you talk about the process of adapting your play to the screen? And I believe this is your first screen adaptation.
Yes, right. The first time I adapted a play into a feature. So it was I was very nervous about, I mean, a lot of things, but because I'm just a nervous person. But I was very nervous about writing a screenplay that felt like a play that had been sort of grafted, or just felt overly talky or overly claustrophobic. You know, because the play, of course, the play is 4 characters, 11 scenes. You know, it's a different structure entirely. So I basically, you know, took the play and said, okay, that's the story we're telling. But basically, you know, started from scratch. You know, and you know, just rethinking the structure entirely and opening up the world. And that was one thing, you know, that was aside from the challenge of how much to see or not see Jake. I think the other big thing was populating this whole world around Alex and Greg. You know, I think in the play there were certain characters that were mentioned but not seen, and sometimes those characters. And there are a lot of characters that are brand new that I've actually gotten really attached to. It's kind of odd.
Can you name some of those?
Yeah, I mean, Priyanka Chopra's character is new. Amy Landecker's character, Greg's client, is not in the play at all, nor is she mentioned. Alex's mother is mentioned in the play, but she's a sort of a different woman in the play that we hear about, and we also don't see her.
Yeah, she was one of the characters that we sort of evolved together because
I think she was less present in an earlier draft, and Silas said, well, there's more here for this mom, which I totally, I'm so happy we did.
Fabulous,
I mean, she's a treasure. We talked a lot about Catherine because she was there, but not as, I think, fleshed out. So yeah, and I think and certainly once Silas got involved, you know, we talked through. Well, I think we, you know, Silas made a really astute observation that pretty much every character in some way is struggling with not living up to the expectations that have been put upon them and not living up to the role they feel they're supposed to be playing. It's not really just Jake, it's everyone in the movie, and that was very you know, it was one of those moments like, oh yeah, that's you're right. that's great. And sort of using that to really to sort of bring that out any way we could, or any way I could in the writing. And, you know, obviously once we had these amazing actors, that also just brings a whole new level. But yeah, I think it was fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun. And like I said, now when I read the play, I miss things that are that are not there.
The cast is incredible, as you both have mentioned, and we are at SAG right now. So, I mean, how did the cast come together? How did you feel, both of you, knowing, oh my God, these amazing actors are gonna be, I'm gonna be directing them, they're gonna be saying my words. Talk a bit about that, just that first realization of knowing I'm gonna work with Claire Danes and Octavia Spencer.
Oh my God. I mean, it's like such a dream cast. Do you want to go first? Because Claire and Jim were attached when
I came on. Jim was the first one cast because he was also he was the one who read the play and said, "I think this, you know, let's make this a movie." So he came on board before there was a script. So he was the one person that that I actually, you know, sort of had in my head as I was writing. That said, I mean, I've always been a huge fan of Claire Danes, and I always thought she would be incredibly right for this role. So it was, I mean, I remember sending an email to one of the producers early on saying, yeah, for what it's worth, I know I'm just the writer, but like, I do think Claire Danes would be like amazing in this part. So when I heard that they actually, you know, had sent it to her, I sort of, you know, fell off my chair and, oh God, or I'm not going to breathe for the next however long it takes her to read. And then it took her like 2 days. It was amazing. She had, like, was on a plane to the Emmys and I guess read it within. It was crazy. I mean, because you never know how long that's going to take. So I was totally elated. And I think even our first conversation, we talked about Judy. It was like, well, if we could have anyone, you know, Octavia Spencer would be like the dream.
She was the first person.
Yeah, I mean, I think pretty much everyone. I mean, it was.
She also said yes quite quickly. And obviously she gets amazing offers. And, you know, just a testament to Daniel's script that the writing was so rich and interesting. And I think actors get, you know, they don't often get these long scenes that you get to like really delve into where it's just, yeah, the actor's sitting in a chair just going at it.
Yeah, I mean, I think there were, frankly, most of the casting news, you know, was pretty surreal. I mean, it was pretty surreal. And because it felt, I mean, again, I think there's obviously to get a movie made, you know, is so hard. And you know, we did get these actors who happened to be quite famous, but they were also like perfectly right for these roles, which is such a, I mean, it's, you know, it's amazing. Yeah.
I mean, and I think that's really a blessing because of course, sometimes you get certain names and then you're able to get other names because the, you know, maybe not always for the best reasons. And we didn't have that. I mean, everyone was so perfect. And because we were independent, it wasn't like we had trailers or, you know, we all hung out on set together. It was a very intimate project. People had to really come on for the love of it and in between all of their other work. So it was, it was extra great that way.
And you brought on Amy Landecker, is that correct? Or suggested her?
I suggested her, yeah. Yeah, because I had worked with her and
Untransparent.
Yeah, Untransparent. And she just goes for it.
She,
you know?
The minute she sits down on screen, first of all, I mean, she just exudes sexiness to me. And it just works in that part. It just, that whole, like, a lot of times, you know, A, B storylines feel kind of thrown together. It felt so real and so important to his character. And
also the humor, like, the moments of humor I felt very protective of, especially with a story that has so much intensity. You need both. I mean, I need both as a person to get through life. And she just brings that, you know, always brings both into the room, you know, the tragedy and the comedy.
What did you say that Jill Soloway says?
Oh, protecting like the holy trinity of dirty, funny, sad, you know? So like in every scene you try to keep and protect that it's not just funny or it's not just sad and then throw in a little dirty. Yeah.
I think I was actually more nervous about casting that role than almost anything else because I knew, you know, if you get the wrong person in those scenes, they won't be in the movie. Like they're gonna get cut. Like if you get an act, because it's there's nowhere to hide in those scenes. It's just those two actors, and so it was like if this is cast wrong, those scenes aren't gonna work. There's no fancy, you know. There's nothing else going on.
You're in therapy.
Yeah, I mean therapy scenes are tough because they can be quite dull if you don't have a really compelling person on that couch. She's incredible.
But it became a really interesting way to learn about Jim's character, I thought, watching him interact with her.
Yeah, I mean, we learn about people by how they interact and, you know, through other characters. So, yeah, it was a really great way. And I also just loved her voice in the story as someone who didn't want to be a mother. I just needed to hear that voice personally as another another opinion and experience in the world.
And then Octavia's scenes with Claire, it sort of balances those out. But what I really loved about this is, you know, you would think it would be Claire and Jim's would be sort of the central thing, but it really feels like Judy is, you know, kind of they're in this triad together.
Yeah, no, I would agree. I would agree with that.
And I think in a way, too, that Judy is this mother figure that she looks up to, like not mother because they're the same age, but like mentoring person that is like she trusts, whereas her family she doesn't trust. And, you know, so it becomes this like really, you know, this layered friendship in a very few scenes that they both, I thought, brought a lot, which is why that last scene is so interesting, because Judy has her ego and her investment and her opinion, and everybody's got something that they're wrestling with in that moment. And I think that the way it gets personal is why it is so riveting to watch.
You can both talk about the decision to reveal that Judy's gay. It comes pretty late in the film, yeah, which I thought was really interesting.
Yeah.
Do you want to go first? Sure. Yeah, I mean, I think it was, that's one of those things where, you know, I think I got a note early on saying, this kind of comes out of nowhere. You know, if we want to set up that she's a lesbian, we should set that up. You know, I forget who was reading. It wasn't someone involved, but they had read the script and thought, you know, why, you know, that's like out of nowhere. And I guess I sort of felt like, well, that's the only time when it would come up. I mean, they know she's gay. It's not a secret to the characters, but as far as an audience, I just felt like it, you know, she's first in, you know, in her early scenes, she's Alex's friend, she's an educator, she's, you know, an authority figure. And until it becomes part of what's going on with Alex and her in the room, I think it would have felt forced and kind of contrived to sort of jam it in earlier just so that we get a clue. I mean, I just think it's something that happens sometimes with characters that are supposed to represent a minority group in some way that we have to sort of flag that for an audience, when I think actually that's not how it works in life, is you meet people and, you know, under different circumstances and different contexts, and, you know, she's not, you know, I think there was someone at Sundance who asked Octavia, I think, you know, how was it playing a lesbian? And she sort of said, well, it's kind of just like playing any other character.
Oh my God. But I will say this, because but Octavia has said this impressed.
Oh, yeah,
so it's okay.
Yeah.
But when we first met, for one, Octavia loved that it came out in the way that it did. And she was, you know, really, she was like, oh, that's so great. I hope that doesn't change. I was like, no, that won't. And then she's like, the other thing is, who's my girlfriend? She was just immediately like, you know, I wouldn't mind, you know, nice, you know, pretty, young, you know, whatever.
Young
I don't
thing.
Know. Yeah. It was just so funny. She was like, you know, but
like, just give me a hot girlfriend and I'll play it.
Yeah.
That was basically her script note, right? It was like, I want
a hot girlfriend.
It's a casting concern.
but also, you know, I think also it's like, I think that note I heard from people who have very great script notes that are, it was interesting, you know, but I thought the same thing. I'm like, there's no reason it would come up.
Right, yeah.
Unless it came up as this sort of worst case question, you know, that happens in the moment that it does.
Yeah.
It's much more interesting to come up that way.
Yeah.
I mean, that to me is
and
that's
more honest.
Very good writing.
Yeah, it's more honest.
It's so funny, that story you tell, but because I think people do, I mean, you know, I'm a journalist, and so you do want to ask about it, but the way you tell that anecdote, it's like, it seems so inconsequential. Like, how did it feel to play a lesbian? Because the character is not, you know, it's just, she's just Judy.
Yeah.
That's Judy.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's, I mean, that's part of her. I mean, that's, you know, I don't think Octavia was, you know, I think she certainly made it a real part of the character, but I don't think it was the make or break, you know, point for her.
And I think that, I mean, that illustrates to me just in general how wonderful it is to see a queer film from an entirely, mostly the people at the top are queer identified. It's just like, it just makes such a difference. And the film is also wonderful and beautifully written and beautifully directed. And, you know, it's not necessarily a correlation, but to me, as a queer person watching this film, it's just, it's like, I can just like take a breath. You know, when I'm watching it, I'm like, oh, I'm not like bracing for something to be off or wrong and feel untrue. How do you both, I mean, you're both sort of coming up in the industry like a little bit, and I mean, how do you think Hollywood is sort of embracing the need for representation behind the camera, the people writing the scripts, people directing? Do you think it's seen as important?
Yes. Yes. And as an up-and-coming, worked my whole life to be an overnight success young director. you know, I kind of gave up on working, on getting paid to, ever to direct, and also counted myself lucky because I still was able to make work with my community of filmmaker friends, and you know, and that work landed and found an audience and played festivals and was noticed and paid attention to, and so I felt lucky. I kept making work. I just kept being engaged in the process, and I didn't wait. And then finally, you know, TV caught up with all of us, and they're like, oh, lived experience makes a difference. It adds to authentic storytelling in many ways, you know, and building stories from the ground up differently. You know, shows like Transparent, I'm on a show called Pose now that has a lot of like new voices in the room, new faces on the screen, telling stories differently, centering lives differently. And I think it's like audiences are ready to have, you know, again, centered stories or just sort of fresh take on things that just feel real and honest. And that comes from bringing different people into the room and behind the camera and the writer's room, the casting. And it's, yeah, I think, I feel like that is... Film, it's happened, but with TV...
It's starting to happen.
Yeah, now it's been, I think, you know, with different platforms, there's a lot more independent film now in television, and so there's a lot more of sort of... And binge releasing makes storytelling these longer format, sort of four-hour movies, and so it's changing, you know, or there's the web series that does the five-minute or ten. There's different formats, there's different timelines, so there's different kind of stories that are... allowed in.
Yeah, I mean, I just think what's most exciting is I think we're starting to see the cracks in this sort of myth that stories told by, you know, queer creators will only appeal to queer audiences. I mean, I think because from a business perspective, if you believe that's true, then of course it's gonna be limited to a small percentage of projects because, you know, and obviously that's just, as you say, the audiences are, that's not the case. I don't think that's actually how we watch things. I don't think as audience members, we like or dislike something because it's exactly like our own lives or our own experience. If anything, I would say it's probably the opposite. If it's well done and well written, you know, if it's well acted, and you know, it seems like I think we're starting to see that, you know, break down. But you know, it's we're not there yet.
Right. So, I mean, certainly this film has the potential to reach a very wide audience, both in the way you wrote it and with the cast. But I guess in centering the parents, was that something you thought about? Was it something you worried about at all?
In terms of...
In terms of sort of centering, like, this straight couple in this queer narrative.
You know, it's fun. I mean, the funny thing is when I wrote the play, I was actually still in graduate school. And the plus side of writing a play in graduate school is you don't think anyone's ever going to actually do it. So any sort of strategic questions didn't really enter my mind because I was just, you know, I'll just write a play. And, you know, it was really my first thing that actually got any traction. I was amazed that the play actually got done. So,
oh my God, the first thing, Jesus.
So I think I was, you know, there were aspects of, you know, relationships I'd been in. There were aspects that from my parents' lives that were interesting to me. You know, it was one of these things where, you know, I had never written a play centered on a marriage before. And I was very nervous about getting it wrong and, you know, having not been a parent. So if anything, I was just worried about, you know, doing a bad job writing a heterosexual marriage, which was not something I had lived personally. So no, but as far as the genesis, I mean, I was happily, you know, not thinking about any of those questions just because of where I was.
Yeah, I think, you know, I didn't worry about it in terms of how it made sense for the story. Like, I didn't worry about it in terms of how we were seeing Jake and But yeah, as a person who's told a lot of stories that are part of my LGBTQ community, I did, you know, really go into the weeds of all the ways I was seeding things to make sure that I was doing it right for myself and my the representation that I felt the burden of, you know? And but it is designed to kind of reach, you know, whoever it reaches. I was interested that this couple should have been okay with this, and they weren't, because I felt like I wasn't hearing that story as much. And I wanted to get away from this polarizing, here's what you should do, here's what you shouldn't do, this is right, this is wrong, because I just don't find that interesting, and it's not how I live. And so I liked that this couple was struggling, even with support around them, and that it's scary, and the world is scary, and you know, you don't know what to do, and you're responsible for this little person, and you do the wrong thing, and I wanted to watch them wrestle with the wrong thing, and you know, whatever wrong, you know, and figure out what the best way to support their kid was, and as a way, because I also work with youth, and you know, because of fear, families still abandon, you know, kick out their kids all the time, and so I love the idea of sort of modeling how to get to the other side. I think that was interesting to me.
One of the most, I want to talk about that fight between Alex and Greg. That's his name, sorry. Because it's so amazing the way you shot it. It's incredibly well written. I would just love to know the genesis of that, you know, from both your perspectives.
Well, I guess of every scene in the movie, I will say that scene is probably closest to its counterpart in the play, which you can probably guess because it's a, you know, 10-minute scene of people talking in a room. And I think, you know, that it was one of those scenes where, you know, there were many other scenes that either, you know, I sort of thought, okay, this will never work, this will work. That scene, it was like, you can only cut it so much because there's certain things these people would only say if they'd been arguing straight for, you know, 7, 8 minutes. And if it's this heated thing that has to build, you know, there are certain things I think if they said what they said, if you cut 3 pages in the middle of that scene, I think some of those lines would seem so overly cruel and unimaginable to say, whereas, you know, if they come in the middle of this kind of messy soup. So I think in terms of the adaptation, you know, that was one place where I thought, okay, this is just gonna have to be a long scene, and I just have to not be afraid to sort of commit to that and trust that with a good director and with good actors, it will feel filmic. It won't just feel like a play on screen. You know, I mean, there were ways in which it was changed, but I think mostly, you know, I was protective of that scene because it felt like in certain ways the core, you know, getting to that really ugly place that you're kind of, they're trying to avoid the whole time, and then when you get there, I mean, because I think to me that's what's so terrifying when you get to a crisis point in a relationship is you don't see it coming. You don't, you know, as an audience, we you know, if you take a step back, but when you're in it, it's like things can get so, you know, go horribly wrong, and you're not sure where or when it happened, and so I think, you know, that I think we just, you know I wanted to maintain all of that and not lose that. But of course, you know, I think it took a very skilled director in Silas, and a very, and also that I have to say the cinematographer, Steve Calitri, did such a beautiful job in that scene. I thought, you know, in making sure it's not just the words, it's also what we're seeing and the behavior and Claire and Jim they're just incredible. I mean, it's just like, it's ridiculous.
How did you approach it, Silas, knowing you had this long, dramatic chunk?
Well, you know, the cinematographer, Steve Calitri, and I spent a lot of time in pre-production thinking about the shots and the visual strategy for the film. And in that scene, I knew I wanted to light the room. I wanted the actors to be able to move, like, you know, if they need, you know, like feral animals, if they needed to be. I kind of knew where they were going to go. I knew that I wanted a house that had that long hall with the other side. I wanted this sort of, that was one specific thing that was about the location manage, you know, in terms of what I wanted to have for them to move the space, what it would look like. But it was a lot about allowing them to move and allowing us to be more frenetic than we had been and jump the line. And our operator, really, he just moved them so well, and that kind of depth of field, I wanted to play with that kind of compression of space and rack focusing with the depth of field and between their faces and, you know, just really feel and be in it. That was the main strategy. And then just, you know, we built to that scene. We were in the house for 2 weeks. So, you know, that was really coming towards the end. That was like our next to last day. Yeah. And so we got to live in that house with them as a couple. And so it felt like a nice, that we had been in that space for a while before going to that.
The other amazing thing was that I think that initially on the schedule, we had maybe a day and a half budgeted, yeah, like over 2 days. And I guess I wasn't there, but I know Claire and Jim said, you know, that they got there and they were like, let's just go. Like they had to do the whole thing in one long day. I mean, they really just, you know, they didn't want to break it up. They didn't want to have to sort of do it over 2 days. To them, that felt counterintuitive, which was really amazing to watch, because in certain ways, maybe that would have been, you would think that maybe it would be easier, but they just thought, no, if we're in it, let's just, you know, we're there.
Oh, that's so fascinating. Well, thank you both so much.
Thank you.
A Kid
thank
Like
you.
Jake, well, it's a wonderful time. Film. Silas Howard and Daniel Pearle, everyone. Tell your friends.